Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to this edition of Disability Viewpoints, now 25 years old. Nick Wilkie is our special guest host today from the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living. And Nick's got a whole bunch of guests he's going to talk about today and the great things they're doing. Go ahead.
Mark, it's great to be here on another episode of Disability Viewpoints. With me on the show today are going to be two representatives from the wonderful organization of Move Minnesota. I have a whole volume of questions for them. I hope we can get through the questions. As we know, transportation.
Take all the time you need. It's only half our show.
It's so important.
Take all the time you need.
Right?
Yeah.
Transportation is so important for people with disabilities. So I can't wait to have the guests on.
Yeah. Well, that sounds good to me, too, and we'll be along with that in a minute. Trevor Turner from the Minnesota Council on Disabilities is going to do the legislative update for us. And, of course, the legislature not so very long ago took a break, but they're all coming back. So he's going to tell us about conference committee and all the good stuff that's ahead there. So we'll be right back with an edition of Disability Viewpoints coming up next. Stay tuned.
With me today is Molly Burns-Hansen and Julie Johnson. They work for Move Minnesota, and they've been nice enough to come on today, and they're going to tell us a little bit more about everything that is Move Minnesota. So without further ado, can you guys tell us a little bit more about how Move Minnesota got started?
Yeah, so in 2017, two groups merged. One was Transit for Livable Communities, and the other was St. Paul Smart Trips. And they came together to create Move Minnesota, whose mission is to lead the movement for an equitable transportation system in Minnesota that puts people first. We work to connect community members to where transportation is working, and then we fight hard to make it work where it doesn't. We're committed to building a big people-powered movement to expand transit, walking, rolling, biking, and all other shared options, because that's what it's going to take to break down decades of, you know, cars-only culture and create a better future for everyone.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Molly. Can you tell us a little bit more about what initiatives you've been part of in the most recent year?
Yeah, so Move Minnesota is both an advocacy and educational organization. I work on the educational side. So I work with community stakeholders, property managers, developers, and district councils on finding ways to break down barriers in transportation. And we are the transportation management organization for the city of St. Paul. So that means that we will be working to provide resources to community stakeholders. So recently, some initiatives are, last year we had a campaign called Changing Choices Along the Sea Line, and that was about getting people excited about the Sea Line, which is a bus rapid transit line. Which means it's a bus that comes about every 15 minutes. The bus stops are in line with the height of the bus, so you can roll on rather than needing to have that, you know, leverage up and down right. Situation. And you also pay before getting on the bus, so it saves time. But these buses go much further distances. So the Sea Line goes from Brooklyn Center through North Minneapolis to downtown Minneapolis.
Okay.
Yeah, so that was an exciting one.
Does Nice Ride used to be sponsored by Blue Cross Blue Shield, the bike program in St. Paul? Are you involved in that too?
We had a connection, but with that being not supported the way it was previously,
right.
There's been
okay.
some changes.
I get it.
Yeah, and Molly works on education kind of side of our organization. I work more on the advocacy side. Which is particularly interesting for the transportation sector because buses and trains move, obviously. So you're dealing with multiple jurisdictions at once.
Right.
Statewide, we get state-level funding, and then we have, like, different roads, sidewalks, and stoplights are all controlled and owned by different counties and cities. And so it makes for some very exciting work
yeah.
as a community organizer. Yeah,
yeah.
so... we work at all those levels, and they're all kind of interconnected because they are in practice as well. A couple of the ones we've been working on lately, Boost the Bus is a big initiative. The theory behind that
I see your shirt there.
Yes, Boost the Bus, yes. not an accident that I wear that today. So Boost the Bus is about how, you know, if someone's using the transit system to get about their days, they're not just using one line. Like, they're going to be utilizing a lot of the full system. So if you, right. So if you want to improve transit and the experience for a rider, you can't just improve one line.
Right.
No matter how great the improvement is, it's not going to make as big of an impact as if you do incremental changes across the entire system. So that's kind of what Boost the Bus is all about, specifically signal priority for buses. So giving the bus the green light in the same way that emergency vehicles get it, a little bit watered down, but the idea is the same. And then dedicated bus lanes so that buses can get through traffic a little faster.
I imagine it gets quite interesting working from city to city and county to county.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Might be a slippery slope there.
It's very much a juggling act for sure. Yeah. We work on, you know, reconstruction. When streets are up for redesign, that's a great way to plug in and get better biking lanes, walking lanes, wider sidewalks, bus lanes, et cetera. So we do a lot of work there. During the legislative session, our main priority so far has been a 1 cent metro area sales tax in the metro. And that would allow, provide longer term funding for transit to invest in both like infrastructure improvements, but also like ongoing work operations, like the transit ambassador program to try and address some of the safety issues.
Do you think with the surplus, there's a good chance that you'd get that 1 cent increase? It's
kind of an interesting game because while we have a surplus this year, the 1 cent metro sales tax is really focused on like making sure we have ongoing funding because right now we're having to do a lot of advocacy every single legislative session to get that funding. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of tangential to the current surplus, but hopefully like with the sales tax, we're able to have funding every year that we can depend on, whether or not there's a surplus or a deficit. So
you both did this a little bit already, but just dive into a little bit about the intersection of your work and the lives of the disability community.
Yeah, so one of my favorite parts about working in the transportation sector and advocacy for it is that it is inherently intersectional across so many different important issues and topics, including disability justice, because transportation is essential for anyone to be able to participate in a community, in a society. People with disabilities are less likely to own a car, and if you can't...
Even for those of us that like them.
Right. If you can't get to work, if you can't get to, you know, if you can't move about your society, your community, you can't get to your job, you can't get to your friends, you can't go to access healthcare, you can't visit the arts, you can't participate in democracy, and it's just like a massive loss for not only people who don't have that access, but also for all the things that they could be like contributing to society with and can't. So it's better for everyone, the people who are part of the like disability community and allies, to have a transportation system that serves the community.
Well, that really
fully
works for a change. You know?
Exactly. So that's
The other, and I think we just saw this a little bit, but what gets you guys most excited about your work?
For me, honestly, it's because two of my biggest values in life are humor and community. So,
imagine that.
Yeah, right? And so I just really love going out into these neighborhoods and learning how people get around, how they connect, and meeting people and finding ways to help them live their best lives. You know, being able to find ways to affordably get from one side of St. Paul to the other, which is not the easiest, but also just learning people's stories and building these long-term relationships to help make a healthier planet. Just makes me really happy, brings a lot of joy, and it's honestly a lot of fun. It is hard, but it's so much fun.
That's awesome. That's awesome. How about you, Julie?
So for me, as a community organizer, like, my work is inherently dependent on the commitment and passion that my volunteers have and the people that donate their time to our work. And so for me, my volunteers are definitely the most exciting part, and being able to connect with people who are willing to provide, you know, their input, their time, and their commitment to this work. It sounds a little cheesy, but they inspire me every day, and that is huge.
You're making a point. Most all of you have the same interest.
Yeah.
And if you're going to have a successful volunteer program, mm-hmm. you have the people with the same interest that you have, and somebody's got to be the leader, and you're the leader, and it sounds like doing a great job. I can tell by the way you speak that
you
move everything forward. Right. So keep going.
Thank you. I appreciate that. It's a really magical thing when you get people in a space that all care about the same thing and are working to make it better.
Mobilize, you know.
Exactly.
Right.
Get the people
so
going.
Can you guys share where's the best place to see Move Minnesota kind of in action?
So, like I said, I'm on the educational side. So we are always working with new properties, property managers. We help with planning for buildings to make them more transit friendly, more, you know, like setting up proper bike racks in the right spot. So we're always active with that. And also just meeting with district councils throughout St. Paul. That's been a lot of my work is... So if you're a St. Paul resident and you're on your district council community board, you'll probably see me.
Do you guys have any events you want to highlight that are coming up?
So many.
Yeah.
So
many. Yeah. We have a lot going on all the time. We're a small but mighty crew. One thing, one is we have two city-specific volunteer teams that meet every month, one for Minneapolis and one for St. Paul and surrounding areas. So the St. Paul team meets from 6 to 7 p.m. on the first Tuesday of the month, and the Minneapolis team meets from 6:45 to 7:45 p.m. on the third Tuesday of the month.
You have to go to both meetings? Or just...
Oh, yeah. I lead them both. but that's really fun.
So you're not home on those nights.
No. Yeah, it allows for community members to have a space and structure and support to advocate for causes that are important to them related to transportation. It also allows Move Minnesota staff to have volunteer support on our ongoing projects and how those intersect. So it's really cool and kind of like a group decision-making body, which is really, really a fun.
As you have things going on, and it seems like you're going to be a promotion in motion in progress, I recommend that you use this studio or call Nick or I. And we can do maybe some inserts or something.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
we have two, if you want to meet us in person, the viewers, if they'd like to meet us in person, we have two exciting things coming
up. Here's where they live.
No, not quite. One is we're going to be hosting a general pub trivia game at Lost Fox on April 25th, 7 p.m., and that's just to come and, you know, play a game, meet us in a casual environment, talk about transportation.
Awesome.
And we're also hosting the Choose How You Move Frogtown Fair in Frogtown at the Frogtown Green Lily Pad on the corner of Dale and LaFond on Saturday, June 17th from 1 to 4. And that's when you can talk to all these different people about all these different ways to get around that aren't reliant on gas-powered cars.
And you'll be there too?
Yep. Well, I'll be there.
And then we're going to be at...
And you're going to be there too?
Probably. We're going to be at the Twin Cities Pride Festival at the end of June.
Awesome.
Tabling there. And then we also have a fundraiser, second annual Rock Your Ride, which is a rock concert featuring a couple local bands. It's a Move Minnesota fundraiser. It's a fun little, like, great time outside.
When is that?
Tickets go on sale May 1st. The event itself is on June 28th. Okay. So.
And where is that at?
Hook and Ladder Theater in South Minneapolis.
Nice.
Wow, sounds
nice.
Good.
Lots of
sounds
stuff
good.
Going up.
You two, this has been amazing. Do you have anything else that you want to share?
You know, I would say, like I said, we're the transportation management organization for the city of St. Paul. So if you want help talking to your employer about subsidized transit passes or, you know, bike parking, anything like that, if you want to talk to your property manager, new developments coming in, you want us to get involved, just reach out to me, mollybh@movemn.org.
And if you're interested in getting involved with any of our events or wanting to volunteer, get involved with our advocacy work, either check out our website, movemn.org, or you can always email me too, which is juliej@movemn.org.
Do that one more time in case people don't have a pencil and a paper.
Oh, the emails?
Yeah.
juliej@movemn.org.
mollybh@movemn.org.
And okay. Move Minnesota's website is just movemn.org?
Yes.
Excellent. Oh, hey, thank Excellent. You both for being here. And please support Move Minnesota.
Macular degeneration, glaucoma, cataracts, diabetic retinopathy. Every day, Minnesota seniors learn that they have one of these eye conditions, and suddenly they're struggling to live with vision loss.
Maybe that has happened to you.
Things that were once easy now seem hard or even impossible. Things you once enjoyed, like reading or cooking or playing cards, now seem like part of the past.
If vision loss is keeping you from living your life to the fullest, give State Services for the Blind a call. We have a team of low vision counselors who go out and meet with seniors in their homes. We'll talk to you about what is working and what is difficult. Then we'll provide you with practical tools and maybe a little bit of training to help you adjust to your vision loss and get back to doing the things you love.
We're here to help take the fear out of vision loss. All of this is at no cost to you, the consumer. It's paid for by the state of Minnesota. If you'd like to know more about how we can help, give us a call at 651-539-2300.
Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. Nick Wilkie is going to join me for the legislative update today. We have Trevor Turner from the Minnesota Council on Disabilities. Welcome to the show, Trevor. And it's still a busy time down at the legislature, House, and Senate. So we want to tell you from your professional insight what you really see going on down there, what you like, what you don't like, or some of the latest and greatest information. Thank you.
Absolutely. Now, 2023 is a budget year, so it means that the legislature needs to pass a budget, or the government will shut down on July 1st. However, with the DFL in control of both the House, the Senate, and the governorship, that's almost certainly not going to happen. And I expect that the legislative session will end as it's supposed to, with no special sessions or anything like that, I believe May 22nd. Mm-hmm. So that will be coming up pretty soon. We are almost halfway through April. But when the legislators return, they will get back together to work on their omnibus budget bills. So right before the legislative recess, they released all of the omnibus bills, which are bills that take all the bills that have been heard throughout the session, and they combine them into one large bill that they'll pass at the end of session. And the goal is to get your bill priorities into those omnibus bills, because if they're in the omnibus bill, they're almost certainly going to pass this legislative session.
And we hope so, because we have some stuff in there, don't we?
Absolutely. And now the omnibus bill, there's always a House version and the Senate version. They usually don't match. They usually have different priorities, different bill, different language in them. And so that means they have to come together in conference committee to reconcile all those differences in the bills. Now, if a bill language is the same in both the House and the Senate, then that will be considered a match, and they will put that aside and let that just stay in the bill. But when things are not matching up, then that's when they start negotiating and trading. I'll include this bill if you include this bill, or I'll include this if you take out that, such and such. And so that will be over the next few weeks at the legislature.
What, as far as the Minnesota Council on Disability, what are your priorities as an organization?
We have quite a few priorities this year. It's been a very busy session for disability policy. The legislature has been very willing to hear disability-related bills. And so we actually have quite a few bills that have been heard and have been included in omnibus bills. And I have actually kept track. So if you don't mind, I'll go through some of them.
Sure.
And Absolutely. So one of the big ones that we have been working on is the MAEPD reform. So this would be the Medical Assistance for Employed Persons with Disabilities reform. This would remove asset and income limits. And this was both included in both the House and the Senate version of the Human Services Omnibus Bill. So that
disabled community would be a good thing if that would happen.
Yeah, so this means that this one has a very strong chance of passing this session until removing assets and income limits for MAEPD. And then we also have in both the transportation omnibus bills, we had disability parking for legal blindness. So they decided to clarify and add legal blindness as a qualifying condition for disability parking. Now, obviously, people who are legally blind are not driving, but they are passengers. And so they will be able to get a disability parking certificate and will be able to use disability parking. And then that was included in both the transportation House and Senate omnibus bills. And then we also have the Minnesota Inclusive Higher Education Grants and Technical Centers bill. This was included in both the House and the Senate Higher Education omnibus bills. This would create technical centers and provide grants for higher institutions of higher education to provide more inclusive programming for people with intellectual and developmental disabilities and things like that, so they can attend higher education and go to a higher university or college or anything like that. And then the Minnesota Council on Disability, we are requesting more funding for our council so that we can provide more services and provide more advocacy for people with disabilities. Our budget was included in both the Senate and the House Human Services
omnibus. So that's a win-win for you.
It is a big one for us. That means we'll be able to, hire more staff and provide more programming and things like that. So we're really looking forward to that passing as well.
Great.
And then we also have the adding driving as an instrumental activity of daily living for PCAs. So currently, PCAs cannot drive their clients as on the clock anyway. So this would be a policy change that allows PCAs to drive their clients.
That's a really old rule.
It's a really big one, and it's been working on for years. So it was included in both the House and the Senate Human Services Omnibus bills. So that's a really big deal and a big win for people who use PCAs. We also are seeing the Rare Disease Advisory Council. They're getting a budget. They're a brand new council, and they actually do not have a base budget. And so this would give them a base budget so that they can continue working and providing advocacy and assistance for people with rare diseases. And that is included in both the Senate and the House health omnibus bills. And then just two more. And then we also have the State Employment and Retention of Employees with Disabilities bill. So this would expand the affirmative action program and help try to increase the hiring and retention of people with disabilities at the state level. And this was both included in both the House and the Senate state government omnibus bills. So that's a really big win for people with disabilities working for the state. And then, of course, we also have the Caregiver Stabilization Act, which was a very large bill. It was Senate File 7, House File 32, and it was a lot of not the entire act was included, but most of the provisions from those bills were included in the Human Services Omnibus Bill. So those are the ones that have been included in both the House and the Senate Omnibus Bills.
Well,
so those are some.
You and I have worked on a special one with Rep. Moeller on a new metro mobility bill to kind of get rid of curfews and kind of clean it up a little bit, if we can use that.
Absolutely.
It would be a system whereby you would get service from 7 in the morning on Sunday till 10 o'clock at night, and I think it's 7 in the morning till 11 o'clock on Monday through Saturday, I believe. I don't
Absolutely.
Have it in front of me, but I'm close. And anyway, it's done. We had some question in the House, but it got through the House and Senate, thanks to Scott Dibble and Senator John Marty in the Senate. I owe them a ton. And Rep. Moeller for her hard work. It did make it into the omnibus bill. So now when we get back, we'll be waiting for a day to go to conference committee. And
absolutely.
I believe it'll be done in the Senate. I'm not sure, but hope it will be there. We have a couple minutes left. Is there anything you want to add, Nick?
I just had a follow-up question, Trevor. When you talked about removal of asset and income limits, is that is that removal of all limits as we know it? That's that's amazing.
That's breaking.
That would be so great.
Yeah, that you know, in the past they've tried to just raise the income limits or raise the asset limits, but this year they just decided because of the political environment and the willingness to do it, they decided that it was easier just to remove all the limits. And we actually had conversations with DHS. They also agreed to that it would actually just be easier just to remove the limits, get rid of those administrative burdens and things like that. So that's a really big one for us.
Okay. That's awesome. Thanks, Trevor. I appreciate the info.
Do you have anything else you want to add, Nick?
No, I'm good.
Hey, Trevor, you get the final word on this segment, so you tell us what we need to know.
Absolutely. And now, so I mentioned all the bills that were included in both the House and the Senate omnibus bills, which means that those are pretty much, I can't say guaranteed, but they're it's very likely that those will pass. But there's also quite a few things that were included in just one omnibus bill and not the other. And that doesn't mean that those are, you know, dead in the water. It does mean that they will have to go to conference committee and have to be worked out. And so there's still a chance for those kind of things to pass. But we, you know, it still requires a lot of work. But we actually have on the Council on Disabilities website, so at disability.state.mn.us, we have a bill tracker, and also have included an omnibus bill tracker for bills that have disability-related legislation in them on our website. So we encourage people to go to our website and to check it out. And I'll be posting this list of bills that have been included in the omnibus bill on our website as well. So I encourage you to go to our website and get more informed.
Thanks for being on the show, Trevor. Thanks for all your hard work. And what that means, ladies and gentlemen, is Trevor has been very, very busy. So watch the State Council website, and you'll be brought up to date on the activity of the bills.
Thank you so much for watching Disability Viewpoints this month. I'd like to thank my guests from Move Minnesota. Shared a bunch of great information. Now we're gonna have you stay tuned for a few messages. And again, thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints.
We want to thank Move Minnesota, of course, and we hope they send their information into our community calendar because it sounds like they have a lot of great events coming up that we hope those of us watching the show at home will attend. We also want to thank Trevor Turner for coming on for the Minnesota Council on Disabilities, telling us about the legislative update and all the good things that are going to conference committee that'll make the disability community even stronger. So for our entire team, Joanne Urbis, Nick Wilkie, and everybody here at Disability Viewpoints, and now in our 25th year, thanks for watching. We hope you continue to watch. I'm Mark Hughes. Bye for now.